În felul ăsta am văzut cum distrugerea statului de drept sfârșește printr-o, de fapt, uzurparea societății civile. Acum îmi face o deosebită plăcere să-l salut și să-l invit să ia microfonul pe Adrian Papahagi, vicepreședinte de la Fundația Creștin-Democrată. Dr. Papahagi.
Thank you, Dr. Namtu. And please allow me to speak in English, because my very short speech is also intended as an answer to what Daniel Hannan has just said before you. And I trust that you all understand English, so that I will not be, it will not be held against me. Now, Mr. Hannan, I thought that you were advocating Euroscepticism here at the wrong time and in the wrong place for us Romanians. And I shall try and explain why that is so. I also identify, and I must confess that myself, I'm a medievalist and an Anglo-Saxonist, and that I am one of the rare people, perhaps in this room, who has actually read the Laws of Alfred and Enid, written in Anglo-Saxon England around 870. And if you're interested what those old Anglo-Saxon laws were all about, I can even tell you in old English. They were about be churchen af soknum, be chlafor selwek, be churchen af frithe, be nunan hemede. Do you understand that? I do understand that. I can even translate that. They're against they're about plotting against the Lord, stealing in a church, or fornication with a nun. And I'm not arguing that fornication with a nun is not a serious business. And as a believer, as a true Christian, I think that fornication with a nun is even a very, very serious matter. But that is not, unless I'm mistaken, the basis of European rule of law. The much decried Norman conquest, which you seemed to kind of, allude to here, is responsible for Magna Carta, and not my beloved King Alfred the Great, about whom I even wrote a book, I must tell you. It's the King of England I love most. So what I'm saying here is that this type of Euroscepticism, which stems from a certain very British contempt for Greeks or Frenchmen or all the same, is not perhaps closest to my heart here, and that I take even the risk of being quickly rebuked by you by stating that I am a Euro enthusiast, especially at a time when Romania is, when throughout Romania there sways a tide of lawlessness, and that we have seen, we have witnessed in these past days that our last resort, our last, defense against lawlessness has been the European Union. And since this is a scholarly conference, I have spoken to crowds over the past 2 weeks, which is not really my specialty. I'm a university professor. I'm rather used to speaking to small audiences like this one. I would like to even be scholarly tonight, ladies and gentlemen, as a change for the demagoguery that I will be obliged to use 2 days from now. And I will start by quoting from Alexis de Tocqueville, and I hope it's not all Greek to you, Daniel Hannan. And I'll quote in French, because we here in Romania like French as much as we do English. And I teach English, but I studied in France. Look what Alexis de Tocqueville is saying in his very famous book on democracy in America. And on a very famously, urgent question, which is the tyranny of majority, la tyrannie de la majorité. Let me say it in French, and I shall translate it if it hurts your ears. Je regarde comme impie et détestable cette maxime qu'en matière de gouvernement, la majorité d'un peuple a le droit de tout faire. La majorité du peuple a le droit de tout faire. In matters of government, he hates the idea that in matters of government, the majority of the people has the right to do everything. And he says, il existe une loi générale qui a été faite, ou du moins adoptée, non pas seulement par la majorité de tel ou tel peuple, mais par la majorité de tous les hommes. Cette loi, c'est la justice, avec majuscule. He writes it with a capital. There is a general law which was made, or at least adopted, not only by the majority of that or that people, but rather by the majority of all humans. That law is justice. Of course, you can call it natural law. You can call it the law of mankind under God. And as a Christian Democrat, I will not contradict you. I will not argue against that. But my main argument is not based on Tocqueville tonight. It is based on the rule of law and on the situation which is so urgent in Romania today. And I'm afraid that our urgency is not Euroscepticism, but rather the rule of lawlessness. Now, my source tonight, and I will only do a close reading of a very famous text, is Hamilton's 78th Federalist Paper. The 78th Federalist Paper, written around 1788 by Hamilton, is focused on the judiciary department. And let me quote and summarize for you what Hamilton is stating in this paper. He says that among the three powers in a state, in any state, the executive holds the sword. That is to say, the executive has the army, the police. It can have the force and wield it. The legislative, he says, commands the purse and prescribes the rules. And we see that is the case in Romania. The executive and the legislative hold the force, the purse and the sword, he calls them. The judiciary, he says, has no influence over either the sword or the purse. In other words, the judiciary can have no direction of strength or wealth in a society. It can take no active resolution. In other more modern terms, it cannot be active, it cannot involve itself actively. In other words, even if you are sentenced to something, the judiciary cannot actually arrest you. It needs the executive power, the sword, to arrest you. It does have to depend on the executive arm for efficacy of judgment, he says. From this respect, the judiciary is beyond comparison the weakest of the three departments of power. And now I'm asking you to ponder on this idea only. I'm switching this off because I have a good enough voice and I hate this microphone. I speak to much wider audiences at my university. As Montesquieu said in his Esprit des Lois, of the three powers, the judiciary is next to nothing. Law, justice, is next to nothing, unaided by the parliament, by the legislative, or by the sword, by the executive. It cannot attack with success either of the two. And thus, Hamilton concludes, all possible care is required to enable it, the judiciary, to defend itself against their attacks. Now, what is happening now in Romania is that the two powers that wield the sword and the purse, the legislative and the executive, have united in an attempt to suppress the third, weakest and most defenseless power, which is the judiciary. And all require, all strength, commitment is required to protect the judiciary. There is a debate now in Romania who has been acting against the Constitution. Has the President acted against the Constitution? Or has the Parliament, the Legislative, acted against the Constitution? Or maybe the Executive? Or maybe the Judiciary itself? What is in the Romanian system, in our constitutional architecture, the place of the President? It's very easy. The President is a kind of referee, but a referee that has some freedom of movement. He can also punch, perhaps even kick the ball. But he cannot actually play. He cannot be substituted to one of the teams itself. He cannot make the rules. But he is there on the field. He has some executive powers because he can preside over government meetings. He can appoint the Prime Minister rather freely, I should say, in this country. He has a say in appointing ministers. He controls the sword in that he is the head of the armed forces and of the secret services, but only in times of need and not directly. He has no real power over the purse, over the money, over the budget. So the president has some executive powers, but he is not actually wielding the sword. He has some legislative powers in that he can sanction laws and send them back to parliament to be discussed again, but not three times or five times, only once. Yet he can dissolve the parliament with great difficulty only. He has some judiciary attributes, in that he can appoint the Chief Justice, Chief Prosecutor, some members of the Constitutional Court, and other high justices. Yet he cannot ever influence their decisions. In other words, the president is some kind of legal warren, legal referee, legal active, half-active player in this play. His role being to keep a balance between all these three powers. Has the president abdicated his duties as a referee, as a balance keeper, so to say? He has not, I shall argue, because he is defending now exactly what Hamilton identified in the Federalist Paper 87 as the weakest and most fragile of all forces, the judiciary. What happens now in Romania and what Europe must know is that executive and legislative have made an alliance to attack judiciary. The only obstacle in their way was the president, and that obstacle has been eliminated. The president is now out of their way, and they can now reach up to judiciary. Consequently, the president has fulfilled his constitutional duty of protecting judiciary, and parliament and government are acting now against the constitution. This is one of the few things that few people have told Romanians. What is happening now in Romania, by the way, has been foreseen by Hamilton in the sequence of this paper, in the following pages. Let me quote from Hamilton. Some perplexity respecting the rights of the courts to pronounce legislative acts void has arisen from an imagination that the doctrine would imply a superiority of the judiciary to the legislative body. Is this too complicated? Let me summarize. He says that there is a risk that the legislative body are themselves the constitutional judges of their own powers. It's a quote. The risk that the legislative body are themselves the constitutional judges of their own powers. You are seeing this happening in front of our eyes. The parliament has just passed a resolution in which it prevents the constitutional court from objecting to laws and resolutions issued by the parliament. In other words, they have become the constitutional judges of their own powers. Our only firewall against this abuse, against this excess, is respecting the constitution against the temptation, Hamilton says, of the representatives of the people to substitute their will to that of their constituents. In other words, the legislative, our MPs, have taken us hostage, they have confiscated our will, our mandate, and they have substituted them to their constituents, to us. Because for us, the only law is the constitution. And this is the constitution that we, the people, have given them to be under. Now they have placed themselves above that constitution by becoming at the same time players and referees. The courts, including the constitutional court, Hamilton says, are intermediate bodies between the people and the legislature in order to keep the latter within the limits assigned to their authority. In other words, the Constitutional Court must keep MPs within the limits of their authority. And he says that the only answer for keeping the balance within a state is a permanent tenure, or at least, let's say, a very long tenure, which is longer than the mandate of ordinary MPs or ministers or even the president. Because what is happening here is an opposition between the judiciary, which is unable to act, actually. It does not have a will. It only has judgment. And the two other arms, which are executive and legislative, sword and purse, which represent will. Courts only represent judgment. They are passive in this respect. So what is happening in this country now is precisely one of the deadly risks that democracy is running, and that Hamilton has foreseen, and that the American Constitution has so brilliantly made impossible. That is to say, the takeover, the hostile takeover of judiciary by executive and legislative. From this point of view, I think that what we are now called upon to do is to defend judiciary and to defend the president, who is so far, or has been so far, the only obstacle in the way of this abuse of judiciary and legislative, executive and legislative, again, judiciary. And in this respect, I'm sorry to inform you, Europe has been a major support for Romania. And if it hadn't been for the European voices of Barroso and Merkel, you know, these European bureaucrats that we all hate, if it hadn't been for those voices, denounced by the socialists who are actually doing a coup d'etat now in Romania, if it hadn't been for these voices, the Romanian people would have been too inert to act effectively against this hostile takeover of judiciary by the other two powers. So I think that Europe is a bulwark. We are not yet ready to get rid of it. Not us here in Romania. You are doing fine in Britain. You're doing fine. Not too fine. You won't go a long way without Europe. You no longer produce much. And your finance is not enough. But you're doing well enough, yes. You have a very long established state, which you have taught us here. I know about that. We are not doing fine enough without Europe right now. So I think we still need Europe for a few decades more. Then we shall see how it all evolves. Thank you very much.